Hello everyone, this is Ashish Jain. This is a continuation video on mutual fund. In today's lecture video, we will talk about the mutual fund ratios. And today we will discuss these five ratios. First one is standard deviation. Second one is alpha. Third one is trend ratio. Fourth one is Sharpe ratio. And the fifth one is Jensen ratio. Now, first question arises in our mind, why we need to study these ratios. First one is why we are studying the ratio, because in the last video lecture we have discussed in detail how to calculate return and how to take optimal decision to get expected rate of return. But the thing is, when you have, like, suppose you have two mutual funds, suppose A mutual fund and B mutual fund, and you want to compare which one is more benefit, or you can say which one is more fruitful as per your portfolio. So which one will you choose? Obviously, you will choose that mutual fund which gives higher return. But the thing is, every mutual fund have different risk. So you need to choose according to the risk as well as per the return, because you know very well that there is a positive relationship between the risk and the return. If the risk is higher, obviously the return would be higher, or you can say vice versa, like if the return is higher, then obviously risk also higher. Okay, so first you need to keep in mind why we are studying ratio, just because so that we can compare mutual fund, or can say, or in any like different investment avenues available in the market, you can compare easily with the help of these ratios. Okay, so let's move ahead and start with the first ratio, that is standard deviation. Now everybody knows what is standard deviation, and you will also know, and you will definitely tell, sir, why you are telling this, because we know very well what is standard deviation. Yes, you know, but the thing is, my basic main is to understand each and every concept in a very simpler form. Okay, so let's start. What is standard deviation? As you know very well, that the standard deviation means when anything that moves away from the mean, or you can say deviate from the mean, that is called standard deviation. Okay, that means if there is any variation, or you can say if the difference between the actual and the mean, that is called standard deviation. So as I told you, like, we are studying these ratio so that we can compare easily between the mutual funds. So how can we compare the mutual funds with the help of standard deviation? Let's take an example. This is the mean graph. This is the mean. That mean means that is equivalent to average. Okay. Now, this is the fund A and this is fund B. Now you can compare easily. This A, that is A mutual fund, is consistent. Or you can say more consistent than B, because mutual fund A has less standard deviation. Standard deviation means the variation. Okay, standard deviation means that is a difference between the actual return and the mean return. Okay, so yeah, as you can say that the mutual fund A is more consistent than B. So how to choose the best mutual fund with respect to standard deviation? That those mutual fund who are consistent with their returns, so that that means they are less risky. Okay, now move on to next, that is alpha. Student, let me tell you one thing, whatever we are studying today that are very important from the the professional courses like CA, CS, CWA, CFA, because in all these professional courses, the examiner will definitely ask the questions from this particular type of ratios. So you need to very clear about all these ratios. Okay. So next one is that is alpha. Alpha. What is alpha? It is a measure, like it is a measure of how a security perform in comparison to the overall market. I repeat, how a security perform in comparison to the overall market. Like if I write the formula for the alpha, so that would be actual return minus expected return. I think that would be, now you have cleared in the mind what is the meaning of alpha. The difference between the actual return and the expected return, that would become your alpha. Basically, alpha denotes the investment manager's ability to beat the market. Higher alpha, that would be most preferable, because it gives the more return than the expected return. Suppose your expected return is 18% and the actual return is 20%, so the alpha would be 2%. Okay, so that means the higher alpha would be better, or you can say most preferable. In any other way, like if you I explain this alpha, suppose sometimes we read alpha in other way, like suppose fund A perform 2%, 2% of what? 2% of the benchmark. Benchmark in the sense, like suppose like in share market we have benchmark like the index Sensex and Nifty. Suppose you want to compare that a particular type of mutual fund with the index, that is Sensex or Nifty. So if if that particular mutual fund is 2% of the benchmark, what does that mean? That means that fund perform 2% more than the benchmark. If it is positive, that is it is performed 2% more than the benchmark. If it is net negative, that means that would be negative side, that means it performed less 2% than the benchmark. Suppose this Sensex basically gives 10% return in a year, and the benchmark and the alpha is 2%, that means that particular fund is giving 12%. Okay, that is 2% more than the benchmark. Okay, so alpha, overall we can say that is the difference between the actual return and the expected return. Okay, and I repeat, it basically denotes the investment manager's ability to beat the market. I hope now you have understood the real meaning of alpha. Now move on to next. The next ratio is that is trainer ratio. Trainer ratio. Let me put the formula first. The formula for trainer ratio is that is portfolio return minus risk-free return divided by portfolio beta. I repeat, the difference between the portfolio return and the risk return. This is your numerator side, and on denominator is portfolio beta. Let's understand this concept in a very simpler form. What this ratio basically tells? This tells basically how a particular fund is this particular fund, how basically this particular fund is providing compensation to the investor by taking an additional risk. See, let me understand each and concept one by one. First, let's take risk-free return. What is risk-free return here? Risk-free return is wherever you are investing in the market. Risk return are those investment wherever you are investing in the market, they are totally risk-free. That means there is nil risk. So what are those investment? Like government bonds, like in bank account, like in FD, recurring deposit, saving bank account. These are all risk-free return. Okay, and the portfolio return, that where you actually invest in the equity market. Suppose you are investing in the equity market and you are getting 15%. So 15% would be your expected return or portfolio return, and the risk-free return, suppose the as per the current, that is suppose the 5%. So this is the your expected return and this is your risk-free return. Okay. Now come to the last point, that is now come to the denominator part, that is the portfolio beta. Now this is a very important concept in whole ratio. First of all, we need to understand why this ratio basically deduced. Because as far as that we have understand, like we have suppose if we take the example of the alpha, do you really think that that it is a fruitful ratio? Like suppose if I want to compare between the ratio, suppose A mutual fund and B mutual fund, so you can say that this is the fruitful manner to compare within the mutual fund. No, why? Because here we are taking only the one factor, that is the risk. Sorry, that is the return. And we, as I told you in the very early in the video, like whenever we are going to compare between the mutual funds, we need to take the two factor. First one is return as well as the risk. But in alpha, we are taking only the return factor, not the risk factor. That's why the trainer introduced the ratio that we need to take the risk factor also. We need to take the risk factor also. So beta basically denotes the risk factor. How? Beta then we generally denotes with the help of times. How? Suppose the Sensex moves 1% up in a day. I'm just taking an hypothetical example. Suppose Sensex increases by 1% in a day, and a particular type fund, that is A, basically moves suppose 1.2% up. So that means the beta would be 1.2 divided by 1. 1.2 divided by 1. So that would be 0.2 times. Or you can say 20% more. Basically, that particular fund basically increases by 20% than the benchmark or than the Sensex or than the index fund. Okay, so beta basically tells how much risk is there in your portfolio. Basically, that how much beta basically tells how much your fund basically moves or behave as compared to the benchmark. It may be positive or it may be negative. Okay. So beta basically tells the risk, how much risk associated with the particular type of fund. Okay. So trainer ratio in numerator side, that we will get the expected return minus risk return, and we will divide it by portfolio beta. Okay. Now suppose if I tell, suppose the there are two fund X and Y. The first fund have trainer ratio, like the portfolio return is suppose 12, risk return so is suppose 4, and the portfolio beta is suppose 4, which comes to 2, and the another one is suppose 16 minus 4 divided by, suppose if I write here suppose 4. Okay, so that means 12 divided by 4, that is equal to 3. So that means the risk is same, but you are getting the more return. So that means higher return would be more, most preferable. We can say higher return would be better. Okay. So this is the whole concept about trainer ratio. Now come to the next ratio, that is Sharpe ratio. Most of the people says the trainer ratio and the Sharpe ratio are almost equal, but that is not true. Although the formula is almost same, but that is not equal. The formula for Sharpe ratio is portfolio return less risk-free return. Yes, numerator is same, but the denominator is different. Now, the denominator would be standard deviation. Now, you know very well the real concept of standard deviation, as I told you in the first ratio. What is the meaning of standard deviation? Basically, standard deviation, why it is here? Because Sharpe ratio basically consider both type of risk. First one is, that is systematic risk. And the second one is unsystematic risk. Now, what is the meaning of this risk? Systematic risk are those risks which are totally uncontrollable. And these risks are controllable. What is the name? Suppose a particular type of fund basically behaves, basically moves upward or downward by all type of risks. It may be by systematic risk or by unsystematic risk. First, let's talk about the unsystematic risk, that is fully controllable. That means, if the fund manager basically diversify our income or our investment in a right manner, so that means that are fully controllable. And if the particular type of fund is basically behaves without any control, like as you know very well, the NAV of a fund basically moves just because of the demand and supply, the forces of demand and supply. If the demand is higher, that means NAV goes going up. If the supply is high, that means NAV will go down. So this can't be controlled by any person. कोई भी इसको कंट्रोल नहीं कर सकता, ठीक है? So these are uncontrollable, but they are systematic risk. And controllable, but they are unsystematic risk. So basically, Sharpe ratio basically consider both type of risk, that is systematic risk as well as the unsystematic risk. Okay, that's why we are taking this standard deviation here. Again, the higher would be the better ratio. Now come to the next, that is expense ratio. What is the concept of expense ratio here? Suppose you all are investor here. You all are investor here and you basically you pool their money to a particular type of mutual fund, suppose X mutual fund, and this mutual fund basically managed by fund manager. Suppose this particular type of mutual fund basically gives, I'm just taking an example, that this particular mutual fund basically gives 20% per annum return. So do you really think that the whole return would come in the hand of investor? No, because if the whole return, entire amount of return that goes to investor, then why the fund manager here is just to diversify your income in the right manner? No, they will also charge some commission. Now that is a main concept. The fund manager basically charge some commission on daily basis that will count under expense ratio. Let me take an example. NAV. Suppose the current NAV is 100 rupees. Okay. Now suppose in just off suppose just I'm just taking example. Suppose market moving very good in a positive side. Suppose the next day the NAV comes to 105. Now the commission charge basically lie between 0 to 2.5%. Basically 2.5% for the equity mutual fund, 2.25 for the debt mutual funds, and 1.5% for the index fund. Suppose you have invested in equity mutual fund, the previous day the NAV was 100 and the current day NAV is 105. Now this NAV, suppose the equity commission is how much? That is 2.5%. So your NAV would be hundred and 2.375 after the expenses, or can say after the commission charged by the fund manager. That means that would be your real NAV. I repeat it again. Suppose the previous day NAV was 100 and the NAV basically increased by 5% in the next day. Now the fund manager basically charge their commission on daily basis. Okay, on daily basis. So that would be 2.5% per annum, not per day. This is per annum. So which means if I divide 2.5 divided by 365, so that means the per day rate would be 0.0068. Okay, 0.0068. So that means your NAV would be 104.99. Sorry, I take up in a wrong. Suppose the previous day NAV was 100. Now the NAV increased by 5%. Now the fund manager charge their commission with the help of expense ratio. Now the expense ratio is for the equity mutual fund is 2.5% per annum. Now this percent would be divided by 365. Okay, now 365, that means the per day interest would be 0.0068. That means after deducting 105 minus 0.006%, the net NAV would be 104.99. Okay, so this is the way of calculating the expense ratio. But you need to learn these ratios. For equity, that is 2.5%. For debt, 2.25%. For index, 1.5%. Okay. Now come to the last ratio, that is Jensen ratio. This is more technical. Jensen basically says that if your overall expected return, that means your portfolio return, is more than capital asset pricing model. So that would be better. That means whenever you are getting more than the capital asset pricing model, that would be most preferable. Now I think that would be your out of mind that sir, what is here CAPM, that is what is capital asset pricing model. Okay, let me try to understand in a very simple form. Capital asset pricing model. Now this is a very important concept. Capital asset pricing model. This model basically says suppose there are two funds A and B, both in both type of fund you are getting 5% return. But suppose the A type of fund, that is totally risk free, and this is the risk, that is market risk is there in this type of fund. So obviously you will go for this because this is totally risk free. You will definitely go for this. But suppose, actually the thing is, wherever you are basically investing in the market, wherever you are investing in the market, suppose if I tell you that the current FD rate is 6.5%, means if you invest in any national bank for a period of 5 years, you will get this rate of return in the FD. Okay, and suppose if you are investing in the equity market in the form of mutual fund, okay, so obviously you will expect more than this rate, but you also want that you must get at least 6.5% because you are taking the risk. So this CAPM model basically says that the expected return of the investor would be first priority gives to that the minimum investment would be equivalent to risk-free return. So that means the every investor must get at least 5%. Okay, plus you know what is beta, that is the sensitivity rate as compared to benchmark. Okay, as I told you, like suppose 1.2 divided by 1 wala. Okay, that is 20%. So that is the beta. Suppose the beta is 0.2, that means you are taking the some risk as compared to, suppose you are getting 18% return extra more than the risk return by taking risk. Okay, so that would be your model, that is capital asset pricing model. सी जिसमें आपको बस थोड़ा सा ये समझना है दैट ये मॉडल आपको बस ये कहता है कि एटलीस्ट ये जो इन्वेस्टर के पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू सोचा हुआ है कि इन्वेस्टर को एटलीस्ट जो है ना रिस्क फॉर रिटर्न तो जरूर मिलना चाहिए. ऑब्वियसली देखिए मार्केट में इतने सारे लाइक इन्वेस्टमेंट एवेन्यूज अवेलेबल है मार्केट में. सो ऑब्वियसली जो लाइक अगर मैं आपको बोलूँ कि अगर एफडी रेट जैसे मैंने आपको बोला अभी करंट 6.5% चल रहे हैं, इफ़ यू इन्वेस्ट फॉर ए पीरियड ऑफ 5% and you going for the FD in any national bank, you will get this particular type of return. आपको इतना मिल जाएगा. But अगर मैं बोलूँ कि आप FD में क्यों जा रहे हो, आप म्यूचुअल फंड में जाओ, so obviously you will expect from that particular type of mutual fund that you must at least get 6.5%. और आपको 6.5% ना मिले तो आप क्यों जाओगे. ठीक है, so CAPM model क्या कहता है कि at least जो है इतना तो मिलना ही चाहिए, रिस्क रेट में मिलना चाहिए. ठीक है, बाकी उसके ऊपर जो भी मिलेगा उसमें रिस्क जितना होगा वो रिस्क के ऊपर होगा. सो मान लीजिए उसमें 18% यानी कि आपको एक्स्ट्रा कितना मिला, 13% मिला, बट उसमें रिस्क कितना इन्वॉल्व है, 0.2, यानी कि सेंसिटिविटी रेट कितना है, दैट इज 0.2, ठीक है। सो ओवरऑल जो भी रिटर्न आएगा दैट इज योर एक्सपेक्टेड रिटर्न, ओके। सो दिस इज योर बेसिकली द एक्सपेक्टेड रिटर्न एज पर द सीएपी मॉडल, एंड व्हेन यू गेट मोर देन दिस दैट वुड बी योर जेनसन रेशियो, ओके। आई होप यू हैव अंडरस्टूड दिस कंसेप्ट, ऑल ऑल ऑफ दिस बेसिकली why we are studying this ratio, so that we can compare any type of fund or any type of stock, okay, with the help of these ratios, okay. So thank you, please keep like and subscribe my channel.